Hi everyone and welcome to a new video. I'm in Colorado Springs with my friend Harnoor. Harnoor, say hi.
Hi.
In this video, we're discussing how you can start coding a little bit faster day over day. And once you do that, it'll compound over years for you to become an amazing software developer. I've been working in the industry for almost 4 or 5 years now. And when I started, I used to hate coding, even though I joined the computer science engineering field because everyone did. And over the years, there are a few things that happened that made me interested in the field. And I think it was those hurdles that I passed that sort of made me go in this field full time. And now I work as a full time software developer. So in this video, I wanted to discuss how you can do things that will compound 1% day over day, which over a span of 3 to 4 years will make you really strong. Why make this video? My goal with this channel is everyone who's watching this video should either start a startup of their own. They should be this good in tech that they can do that, or wherever they're working, whichever company they're working at, they're either leading a team there, or like they're the person everyone looks at, they're the man or the woman in case anything goes down, or like everyone looks up to. I've seen a few people like this in my career, and I want you guys to become that kind of a person when you join the industry and start coding full time. And in this video, I'll be sharing some steps that will help you achieve that hopefully in a few years. With that, let's get right into the video. The first one is start to learn new things. The internet is filled with roadmaps, which I'm guilty of making as well. But in the end, there are a lot of things in technology, so you can start with a very broad aspect of things. This can get a little overwhelming, but when you're just starting out, when you've not ever coded ever in your life, the first thing you should do is look at everything that's around. There's blockchain these days, there's Web3, there's full stack development. There are a bunch of other computer science fields, even like concepts like OS and DBMS. Just understand how these things work from the very top. This will make you a computer science nerd. And basically, now you understand the basic jargon that's happening all around you. If you don't do this and start directly coding in Java, let's say, then it can get a little overwhelming, and then you don't know what's happening all around, and it's very easy for your graph to go down, and then you just leave coding, and or you become like an average software developer, or you remain constrained to that one thing that you understand very well now. But if you want to be leading a company, there are a lot of aspects that could go down on a day-to-day basis, so you should have some idea around a lot of things. I'll give an example here. I did an internship back in college, and over there, I was the only one who knew how version control or Git and GitHub work, because I had done Google Summer of Code in the past, and this is like a very basic prerequisite for that. And I saw all interns around me struggling, even though Git and GitHub are like such basic concepts that you should know before you're joining the industry or working as an intern. And hence, this idea behind me poking my nose everywhere and trying to understand, okay, how does this happen? How does that happen? It made me understand a lot of things, including Git and GitHub. And then once I reached there, I was the only intern who I basically helped everyone push their code because they weren't able to do that. And since they weren't really interested in the technology, they were really just interested in getting out of there in 2 months or like getting a PPO. They didn't really learn it through the internship either. So if you don't know anything, try to learn it. There are friends around you. And if you keep doing this over and over again, eventually you'll realize you have a basic overview of the industry, which is super helpful and super powerful when it comes to becoming a software developer. With that, let's move to the second point. The second point is learning how to debug. I'll start with an example. When you're writing a basic HTML, CSS, JavaScript web page, most of the times there might be some bug in there. And the way to find that bug is that you add a lot of logs in your code and then try to look at which branch of the code is getting reached based on the logs. This is a good way to start, but this will slow you down. And it's, again, very easy to just become complacent since now you know there's a way to just add logs everywhere and then find the bug. But this is not the right way to do it. There are debugging tools out there. There are breakpoints. There's a full-ass Chrome inspector that was built for the purpose of debugging. And this is something you should definitely learn. If you're going deeper into some language, the same logic applies. People do a lot of log debugging, which is not the best way to debug. So you should get comfortable around how you can debug fast. And the way to learn how to debug fast is to get out of log debugging and either get into breakpoint debugging or something even more difficult. The reason this is important is because you won't realize how much time you're wasting in log debugging or standard practices of debugging. And you'll only understand the power of other smarter ways of debugging your code once you do them. And then there's no real going back. You'll never go back to adding logs to your code to debug it. So always, always, always start with the basic debugging approaches, but then understand what's the best way to debug a language. There are always tutorials out there that can help you. And I may link some in the description as well. So the first one that you can start off with is looking at the Chrome inspector and analyzing and debugging your JavaScript code when you're writing a website. That's a great starting point, and most IDEs then eventually have a similar interface for you to add breakpoints and inspect your code as it runs through. This takes me to my next point, the third point being IDEs and getting very comfortable with IDEs. I've said this before, the more powerful your IDE, the faster you'll be when you're coding. And this is a very long and challenging process, doesn't happen in one day. Till date, I am trying to move to a better IDE, and my goal for this year is to understand Neo Vim very well and make it my primary IDE. But you don't have to start there. You can start at least from VS Code and then try a bunch of IntelliJ IDEs, which are very language specific but extremely powerful when it comes to debugging and other sort of shortcuts, and create a very nice shortcut flow for yourself. When you're working on some product, eventually it becomes very repetitive. And if you have the right set of keystrokes assigned to the right set of commands, you'll realize you can code with your eyes closed. I realized this very recently, but there was a certain bug in our code base that I couldn't really figure out how to fix. So I had to make a bunch of changes which were very similar. And then eventually I realized I could just close my eyes and code them. And even further, I just wrote a script that would basically do all the things, and then we would try one by one the thing that we were trying to fix. Add such tools for yourself, and the IDE is the best way to do it, because IDEs are built to make you a faster developer. Only you need to understand their power. Start with basic IDEs, and then I am very biased because this is an IDE I've seen every powerful coder around me use. So Vim, NeoVim, Emacs, eventually try to converge to one of these. And I think this can lead to extremely high output as long as you're comfortable with the IDE. With that, let's move to the fourth point. Create scripts for repetitive tasks. The purpose of developers, the reason software development was made, so that we can make repetitive tasks faster, make the machine do something that humans were doing before. And there is speculation that machine learning and AI is going to replace what developers do right now, and then machine will basically code itself, which is speculation, may or may not happen. But right now, the purpose of a software developer was to make things faster via code. Why not make your workflow faster via code? I'll give an example. I used to work at a company where the version control system was not Git. It was an internal version control system based on top of Mercurial. And the way to push, there was no concept of branches. There was a very weird way for you to push code into their so-called repository, which was also very internal. But I realized there are six steps that I'm following again and again. I saw myself writing the same commands six times, and then I collapsed them into a single script, and then it was more or less automated. Look for things like these around you. Another task that should always be automated is deploying your code onto the cloud. If you're writing a backend service or a frontend service, you should not be deploying it by hand on the cloud. You should only be pushing it to your version control system like GitHub. And then eventually it should deploy to your servers in a very nice, clean, smooth fashion, and understand how that happens. I know it's very easy once you understand the flow of, okay, pushing to GitHub, pulling to your server, and then restarting, and then you get very used to it. But there's a reason CI/CD was built, there's a reason tools were built, and there's a reason software developers are supposed to make things faster and not slower. And so get out of your comfort zone and try writing scripts and automating tasks on a day-to-day basis. I recently made a video where this is like a fun video, but what I did there was I automated the process of accepting all my LinkedIn requests because I had too many. Now, as a human, you could click on them one by one. But as I said, since you're a developer and you're very powerful, you should write a script to do it. Check out the code if you want to. It's open source. I'll link it in the description. With that, let's move to the fifth point, maintaining quality. For you to become that person who everyone looks up to in your company, you have to be the person who writes extremely solid code. And I've been guilty of writing really dirty code, especially in startups, because you have to move really fast. But if you have to spend like 10 more seconds to clean something up, you should do it, because that will eventually convert into a habit. And the other side of this is, if you write ugly code, that will also become a habit, and then it's very hard to get out of it. A few things or examples to mention here are, if you see that you're writing code that's already been written, abstract that out into a function, that's the start. And then there are reasons why polymorphism is taught in college. Understand why it's taught, and why you shouldn't just write code two times which looks very similar. Understand why interfaces were written and why you can extend classes, why people created the whole concept of object-oriented programming, because there's a reason these were built, there's a reason these are very strongly used in big tech companies where there are a lot of software developers coming in and out every day. And then they have to make sure that the ramp up time for a new software developer isn't too much. These practices make your code much more strong and stringent. And that's super useful when you have a very big company like Facebook, which has like a single repository of the code base, is what I've heard. I haven't worked there, but from what I know at Facebook, the language that they use is very similar to JavaScript. Again, I could be wrong, I haven't worked there. And it's very strongly typed. So if you're a new developer that joins the company and you make a change in one place, every other file that you might have touched or which might have broke, the types are so strong that it'll just throw out red errors at you, and then you can just find your way to all the things that you have to fix. Compared this to JavaScript, where there are no types, and you just make a change in one file, you don't know what all functions touch that file recursively, and then you're just opening the browser, looking at an error, and then trying to fix it. So, slowly and steadily, start understanding and applying computer science concepts that have been built over the years, because if you dream of working in FANG or some big company, you'll definitely need them. And even if you're working at a startup, like a scrappy startup, it's always good to be the person who sort of cleans the code up as time goes by, because then you're looked up to as the person who's sort of maintaining the code, and it'll of course increase team productivity. And if you're the person who's increasing team productivity, most probably your salary will go up, because if you're increasing the productivity of 10 people, you're basically saving them 1 hour a day, which is great. And then the overall outcome that you've made is huge. Those were all the points. So 5 points, try to implement them in your workflow. Let me know if you have any other questions in the comments. With that, let's end the video. I will see you guys in the next one. Peace.